Do you think life is simpler as time evolves? For some, it can be more complicated when facing issues about health, estate plans, probate, long-term care, and more. That's why Attorney-CPA Joe Cordell hosts ElderTalk with TuckerAllen, providing intelligent answers for those thinking about their future. Here's Attorney-CPA Joe Cordell.
Welcome to another episode of Elder Talk. This week, we're going to return to a topic that we've talked about a couple times in the past. You know, we like to look for opportunities in the news where we can find stuff that's, is juicy too strong a word, interesting. That's more dignified.
I like juicy, I think. We're nosy.
Okay, well, it's interesting, well, at a minimum. And it's also an opportunity to learn. So we want both those elements to be there because this show exists to help you be more effective as you, as we, all of us age, is for us to learn more and to be better with our money, to be better with our health and how we conduct our lives, et cetera. So it seems that Britney Spears is an ever fertile source of information of interest as well as opportunities to learn. You want to learn from other people's mistakes at least as much and perhaps a lot more than you do your own. That saves you having to go through it. But in any case, we return to this topic because it has had a few turns in the road from when we talked about it before. So there were some things pending. So we took this as an opportunity to talk about conservatorships. Those of you who've seen the previous show, if not, go to our website. You can look up that show by its title. It'll refer to Britney Spears. So that show is an opportunity to explain how guardianships and how conservatorships work, and is this an option for you, perhaps as it pertains to a family member? Could it potentially be something that you yourself would be the subject of a guardianship or a conservatorship, perhaps as you? Any of us could be as we age. So it's good to know something about this mechanism and how it affects our lives and our finances, et cetera. So as luck or serendipity would have it, it seems that there's actually a pending hearing as we talk. Is that correct, Jill?
As we speak, we are on the Britney watch. Several things are happening in court today.
You should introduce our learned guest, our authority on this subject.
Yes, that would be Jim Gau, attorney at TuckerAllen. Thanks for coming back for Britney's battle.
Yeah, esteemed guest, Jim Gau.
Esteemed. Excuse me, my goodness.
Well, I can tell you that she is keeping lots of attorneys busy, I can tell you. Not just the ones commentating as Jim Gau is, but also she must have, surely, on both sides of the table. She's paying for all these lawyers, incidentally. It's all coming out of her pocket. So she has several lawyers I know on this.
Matthew Rosengart, her newest attorney.
Oh, really?
Well, yes, because a judge last summer granted her request to be able to hire her own lawyer.
Yeah.
Because before that, she wasn't competent or deemed competent to hire.
The catch 22 of, I need a lawyer to prove I'm competent, but I'm not competent to get the lawyer to prove that I'm competent.
Yeah, this is an issue in a lot of states. We won't go down that hole, but it is an odd situation that in some states, this has not been resolved. So somebody who's accused of being incompetent and they were found incompetent and they want to challenge it, they're deemed by some states to not be competent to pick a lawyer. So there you go. They're forever caught in this situation where they can't defend themselves and get this wrong righted. So, but the state of New York, to their credit, is among those states. I think Missouri is too, where you can insist on hiring your own lawyer if you want to challenge a conservatorship. So, let's set this up. Let's get a little bit of an overview of kind of what's happened so far.
Well, since our last show, Dad, Jamie Spears, agreed. He filed a motion to step down, gradually, that is. And then later on, correct me if I'm wrong, Jim, filed a motion to end the conservatorship altogether. However, Britney Spears and her lawyer haven't filed that motion. But all of this is being heard during a status hearing today.
Yeah. Yeah, so it looks like Britney, back in July, I believe, originally filed the petition to replace her dad, and that was supposed to be with a CPA. accountant.
Right.
And then after that, you know, it all came out in the news, and I think things started to heat up a little bit. And then Dad came out at the end of August-ish and said, you know, that he would step down, and like you said, gradually, and they'd come up with a kind of a plan to either terminate or for him to step down and be replaced. But since then, it was only a week or two after he said that, he filed an actual petition to end the conservatorship completely. So not only just step down, but actually petition to end it.
And you know what? I just can't help but wondering, all the accusations Britney Spears made in open court, especially the accusation she made during the hearing on June 23rd, accusing her dad of conservatorship and abuse, and said she wanted him investigated, wanted charges brought against him. Does it make you wonder if maybe that's the reason? Because there, you know, if he did commit, you know, if any of this is true, he could face criminal charges. Mm-hmm. Am I right?
Yeah, and we'll be a little more specific. Is this the allegation that he had bugged her room, her bedroom, or that he was at least bugging conversations that she was having?
That's
that
according to a new documentary. But she said that he would not allow her to have a baby. He controlled who she would see.
Yeah, I think it was just a combination of everything.
It was several things.
Because there's a lot of financial stuff at stake, and he's negotiating all of her contracts and negotiating himself into them and getting royalties for things like merchandising and stuff like that. So I think it was just a combination, not only of, you know, the physical and mental abuse that she had claimed he was doing to her and talking to her and basically
keeping
talking
her
down on her.
Keeping her on mood-altering drugs.
Yeah.
You know, that does sound like something that, if it were true, would be clearly actionable. I mean, the standard of care for a conservator or a guardian, but a conservator, some of you may remember, not all states make this distinction. Some will simply have one phrase, it's called a conservator, or they'll have another phrase, it'll be called a guardian, that will refer to both the care of the person, which is a different set of decisions, whether, you know, if it's somebody young, do they go to a certain school? Do they take certain types of medicine that are discretionary? Those decisions versus financial decisions where it's entirely a matter of managing money, not making decisions about where they live, whether they marry, things like that. So that's guardian activities is the personal activities. Money, it relates to conservatorships. And in the state of Missouri, for example, you do have two categories. So you'd have one person that'd be one for the other. And I think that's true in New York, is it not?
This is in California, though.
Oh, this is in California. Yep. So is it true in California?
I believe so, because right now there are two different people in the two different positions.
Okay.
So, yeah, there's a guardian of the person and conservator.
Jody Montgomery is the guardian of her person and Dad's guardian of her finances. But he did serve in both roles until 2019. And Jody Montgomery came on board because I believe the dad was having some health issues. Mm.
So one thing, though, that seems like a red flag here is it would be, you know, just a textbook case of violating your fiduciary duty if you're in the role of a conservator, which is a sacred role requiring that you be disinterested, meaning that you not be in a position to profit even indirectly from a decision. I mean, it's this real, real, real high standard of trust. And so when you've heard that phrase fiduciary, that's the reason your financial advisors don't want to be categorized as fiduciaries. This big fight going on in Congress is they've tried to avoid that because they think a big blow to the industry. It means that if they tell you that you should buy an annuity, that it has to actually be beneficial to you. So, I mean, that sounds like, well, of course it should be beneficial. Well, the law doesn't require that standard necessarily unless they're a fiduciary. If they're a fiduciary, then suddenly everything they say to you, it cannot be driven by their personal interest. So if they advise you, I'm not picking on anybody who recommends an annuity, but annuities dump a lot of cash into an advisor's pocket on the front end when they sell one. So one could argue that if they're fiduciaries, that they might be in a position where it's more difficult for them to advise you to go get and to buy from them an annuity. So what surprised me in this conversation is that her dad could have profited financially in this role as a conservator.
It's odd to me as well, because even when we draft trusts, there's always a provision in there for trustee self-dealing.
Self-dealing.
And usually it's simple to get around. You just bring in a disinterested third party that can sign off on the deal. And so it's kind of like attorneys, you know, we can't take gifts. We can't purchase real estate from our clients because there's a role of trust there. We're fiduciaries. And so, you know, the law thinks that we may be able to trick our clients because they trust us so much. And so, you know, bringing in a third party for any kind of transactions like that are required if we're going to do any business dealings with clients.
That's a really good point. So that people are clear on that, it means that what he might have done is he may have met the fiduciary requirement by going to a third party, saying, look, go to this attorney, for example, probably literally an attorney, and have them review this contract that I'm about to sign for you, or maybe get an attorney to sign off on it. Remember, she's incompetent, so she can't do anything, presumably, that requires any responsibility. So somebody would have approved it. So I think you probably explained it. I'll bet surely he got some third party to approve.
I would hope so. Or maybe he went to the court for approval, but I think
that's a possibility. Yeah. These are all good points for you to learn a little bit about this. Guardianships and conservatorships are very hands-on. They're pretty inefficient in most states, and they suck up a lot of money. Court costs, lawyer fees, accountants, you know, it's all being paid for by you if you're the one who is the subject of this order. Or if you're doing it on behalf of someone else, it's going to come out of their estate. So this is the sort of thing where if he really wanted to be protected, he took it to the court and asked them to approve it. And if it had all the indicia of something that was good for her and that he's uniquely qualified to serve this role, then it might have been that a judge would have approved it. So these are the sorts of things, though, that make this so clunky and awkward and inefficient, is that you have this fairly heavy court oversight.
And we talked about this before. This is not your typical case of a conservatorship. I still don't understand how this even happened. She was 26 years old, doing some crazy things, blowing her money. But again, explain what the typical case looks like.
I mean, the typical case is, you know, either it's usually a minor or an older incapacitated adult that clearly cannot make their own decisions, or if they're a minor, obviously they're not legally capable of making their own decisions yet. And then normally if it's someone in between, that it's clear that they have psychological issues, that there's no way they can manage their funds. But, I mean, here you've got some psychological issues. You know, I don't know what her financial situation was like, but, I mean, being rich and young and having money isn't an indication that you're incapable of managing affairs.
In California, that must be a pretty low bar behavior.
Mick Jagger was just in town, and I'm sure there were times in his life when they maybe had questions of his capacity. So
it is a little surprising that this happened. And I think in part it only happened because she cooperated.
And the reason she did, it had to do with the whole child
custody
issue with Kevin Federline, and a judge had suspended her visitation with the children, and she must have been told, according to sources, she was told this will help her get custody back of her kids, and they were pretty young at the time.
And this was how many years ago was this?
This was in 2008.
Okay. Yeah, 13 years, yeah.
So the kids are grown by now.
Right. Yeah.
And I think that were it not for her cooperation, I think that really is the single element that explains this. I think if you take that away, it would have been very hard, I think, to have her declared incompetent and to lose her freedom. I mean, competency is a big, big deal in America, where we have a constitution that assures us, you know, certain freedoms, including expression and life, liberty, pursuit of happiness, all that. Well, you lose your say in those things, quite frankly, when you're declared incompetent. And it means that somebody else is determining where you live, even when you marry, depending on some states might lift certain restrictions. But for the most part, it applies to everything, including marriage.
Yeah.
I have a question. If Britney would have been a minor when this occurred, say she was 15 years old, mm-hmm. would she had to have agreed to this or because she was a minor, would she not have a voice in it?
No, she wouldn't have a voice in it. But, you know, let's say she was 15. 3 years later, it's presumed that she's met the age of majority and that she should have her rights restored, essentially, or I guess at that point granted to
but
her.
But would she have to petition the courts or her attorney?
No, they would have scheduled a hearing right around her 18th birthday and kind of an automatic thing. Hey, do we need to terminate this, or do we have medical, you know, showings of disability, and should we continue this on as an adult guardianship?
Yeah, she's presumptively incompetent prior to adulthood, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
So in this case, though, we had just the perfect storm where you did have some crazy behavior, but again, nothing that would have shocked anybody in California or much the United States, given what some people do. We all know people who've lived their lives this way, rich or poor.
Well, yeah. Child stars. How many child stars have done crazy things?
Yeah. And how many people that we know? I can think of a few people I grew up with in Appalachia who, I mean, that the norm of behavior in there might have suggested some
sort of... I gotta visit that town.
Watch any MTV reality show and there's conservatorships just being handed out on a pad of paper from any of those people. Yeah.
So here what the mistake was, she participated in this, and I do think it probably related to she was threatened with not having visitation with her kids because she had behaved so crazy. Now, that's not that unusual. It doesn't mean you're incompetent when you're denied having custody without supervision with your kids. It's not typical, but any divorce lawyer sees cases like that once a month almost. That may be too often, but it's not that unusual where you have somebody who, whether they're engaging in some sort of self-destructive behavior, maybe they're an alcoholic, maybe they've had like four DUIs. I mean, there are lots of examples where a judge will buy the argument that, yeah, of course this parent should not lose their right to be a parent, and yes, they can see their child. Rarely will a judge say that a person can't see their child, no matter how bad they are. I think Jack the Ripper would have a right to see his child.
Okay. Supervised.
Yeah, not for child-rearing purposes.
Right.
So in terms of playing that sort of role, yeah, courts do look at you know, the parent's character and their responsibility. So it's very conceivable that she would have gotten access to visit with the kids, but it would have been supervised. It's not that uncommon. Thankfully, it's not, I'm happy to say it's not common. It's the standard for having your child unsupervised as a parent is actually pretty low, and I would argue it should be. I mean, people, you know, are entitled to be parents, and to a point they're entitled to be bad parents,
yep.
to a point. And so, thankfully, there's not this real high bar. Many of us would find that, you know, somebody's decided we shouldn't be parenting our kids. So in this case, though, they would have given her certainly supervised with, you know, access to her kids, but on a very limited basis. They probably wouldn't be staying with her alone at that time because of her behavior.
Yeah.
And why she thought that it was a good strategy long term, I don't know who would have planted that idea in her head. It almost is evidence of incompetency that someone would do something so foolish.
But maybe she was just that naive.
Yeah. I mean, this is her
just
dad.
Not that bright. And she had her dad, her mom was in on it too, and then attorneys were speaking with
friends.
Her.
Yeah.
So her parents, who she trusted, were probably saying, do this.
Yep. And there was a family friend, I believe, that was involved. It was one of mom's friends, I think.
Yeah, who became her.
Same thing. Said, hey, you know, you do need this. And she testified, I believe, in court. But it was more of a, they all thought it was going to be short term, and it just didn't turn out that way.
Yeah.
But, I mean, surely the parents had a lawyer who was telling them, at least, that this is going to maybe difficult to undo. I mean,
you would think
these things are much easier to create than they are to rescind. And it's because the underlying reason somebody's declared incompetent are usually not transient. Courts would be reluctant to use incompetency for something that's transient because it's so grave to deprive someone of their liberty. And it is that. It's depriving them of their liberty in many ways. So I'm just wondering, how could the parents have advised that, or how could they have thought reasonably that this was just temporary?
I don't think they did.
Yeah.
At least not.
The dad, I don't think the dad did.
No, and mom eventually turned on the dad.
Yeah.
And they were divorced by this time. I believe they divorced in 2002.
The parents.
The parents, yeah. So in 08 and 09, when all of this is unfolding, they're on the same page, you know. But I think as time went on, mom started seeing how this was not such a good idea. Mm-hmm. And she came out and spoke in support of her daughter and did not think the father should remain on this conservatorship.
Well, yeah, I think in fairness, we should make a couple points that the other side would make. One of their best points has been that the money had, that she's actually prospered, that she's grown, you know, more wealthy during this period of time, and probably more than she would have without it. I think that's an argument I wouldn't have trouble believing, because I mean, I'm granting their argument on the front end that she was irresponsible, doing silly and crazy things. And I would certainly, I mean, if Lisa Presley, is Lisa the daughter?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. If Lisa Presley can go through a couple $100 million in 10 plus years, whatever it was, mm-hmm. and no one suggested she was incompetent.
Right.
And I think that Britney in the condition she was in back then would have gone through whatever money she's had then as well as in the meantime? Mm-hmm. Probably. So it is fair to say that she now has a nest egg where she's older. How old is she? 40?
30, oh, 39.
Isn't she older than that?
No, I want to say she's late 30s, maybe 40 at the oldest.
I think either 39 or 40. But the point is, whatever she is, she's older and she has a better shot at keeping her money now than I think she would have 13 years ago. So she's going to step into, how much money was it? Several million.
Yeah, I can't remember what the exact numbers were, but they did say she was down to, you know, almost $1-2 million, and now I think she's up to, I want to say 40 or 60?
61 million.
61.
61, that was
right.
Boy, that's good. 61 million.
See, I pay attention. Yeah.
So, now one thing good about this is if she just has the wisdom to not screw up the money piece, assuming that this conservatorship is ultimately dissolved, and I do think that's where this is headed, and would it have happened this way at the average person? Maybe not. If you were a normal person and didn't have much money to hire lawyers and weren't going to have a whole lot of press putting pressure on the judge is under pressure just like mm-hmm. the dad. I mean, the judge is going to get a lot of bad press if her attorneys, which I don't think they have yet, but if they end up submitting a petition just to dissolve this and end it, I can tell you that the popular press is going to go from talking about how bad the dad is to talking about the judge. And so I think I think this is destined.
Yeah. Well, it's a circus outside this courtroom right now. I mean, they have streets shut down. They have the media. They have
Is this
fans.
L.A.?
This is in L.A.
Yeah, yeah.
They are closed, and they've got the Free Britney protesters right outside the courtroom. Wow. Now, she did get engaged after this, and she is seeking a prenuptial agreement, which tells me she's responsible.
Yeah.
Because when mm-hmm. we're talking about that much wealth and celebrities, that's something you do want to have in place.
Definitely.
And I want to say when she married Kevin Federline, she didn't get a prenup. Because they did like a spur-of-the-moment Vegas wedding, if I remember right. They did get a post-nuptial agreement after they were married.
Well, and she did marry that childhood friend in Las Vegas. You remember?
Maybe,
that was like
maybe in conservatorship's not that bad of an
2003, she was out partying with her childhood, some guy she grew up with in Louisiana. And, you know, they're partying, decide to go to the Lucky Chapel
And get married?
And get married, yeah.
At the drive-up window?
Yeah. And
cheeseburger fries, wedding ring.
Yeah, and then the very next day, mom and her manager got there and they had it annulled like within 10 days. Mm.
This is a pretty incriminating trail of bad. But again, I stand by my position. This is by no means.
No, they did have a wedding. Kevin Federline, yes, at Britney's house.
Yeah.
That's right. They did. They had a regular.
You don't remember following this story?
Oh, no.
I do remember this now.
What were you doing?
They
probably
did.
Something that wasn't important.
Probably something that wasn't as, not as important as this.
Yeah.
So, but there's only been There's one marriage that was annulled, but this, but only one marriage that stood.
Right.
And that was, that ended,
In 06, 07.
And helped trigger all this.
Right. Because the child custody battle was going on after that.
Yep.
But the actual marriage was dissolved in right around
that
time.
And those, in fairness, I mean, a custody battle is a very stressful thing.
Mm-hmm.
And over the years, you know, in my role as a divorce lawyer for 25 plus years, I can tell you that, you know, it's not unusual for the parents to do things that are not helpful at all in a case. And sometimes it's just pressure. If they're vulnerable, for example, to anger, if they're vulnerable to depression, if they're vulnerable to taking drugs or even just drinking too much alcohol, if they have those vulnerabilities, then you put them in the pressure cooker of a trial and in preparation going into the trial, depositions where bad things are said about them, where they have to sit across the table and somebody insinuates that they don't love their kids, that they've been dishonest, that they've been a bad parent, among many other things, accuse them of sexual improprieties, et cetera. Maybe they're accused of abuse. If you're a guy, it's less common with women, but if you were the husband in a divorce, I can tell you the odds are much higher that you'll be accused of some sort of abuse, psychological, physical, something. And then I can tell you as a fact that often those charges are not true. I'm not saying that they're always not true. Obviously, they're sometimes true. But I can tell you that more often than not, among my clients, they were definitely not true. However, that's the sort of pressure cooker that these people find themselves in. So it brings out often disastrous consequences for these parents. Mm-hmm. It's like the thing you want so badly, you want to win this hearing, you want to have access to your kids, et cetera, it causes you to do things that actually reduce the probability of your getting there. And I find that parents, no matter how you coach them, there are some parents that, despite the coaching along the way that attorneys are supposed to do, as well mm-hmm. as other parties that may be involved in this or other professionals that may be involved, some people just cannot follow the roadmap. I mean, I think it's probably emotional. I think it has to do with personality, but they just can't do it and they end up screwing things up. And she may be that sort of personality that's fragile in that way.
And whenever your life is being put under a microscope, you're going to be defensive, even if it's completely baseless. I mean, you're being put in a defensive position.
Well, yeah, this is all playing out in front of the media.
Yeah, especially.
Yeah. So if this conservatorship would remain in place and she does have another child, like she has said she wants to do, how would this impact another child, a minor child?
That's an interesting question. Why don't you take a whack at that?
Yeah, I mean, she's still the parent. Obviously, there's two parents involved, unless she did an artificial insemination or something like that, which is an even crazier path to go down.
Yeah.
So there's going to be parental rights still of that child, and no one, unless someone is telling her, you know, basically, because grandparents can file, for example, for the custody of a child. Mm-hmm. So unless someone else is trying to kind of go around her and say she's absolutely an unfit parent, which is different than just having the capacity to manage your finances or, you know, she's got a guardian of a person. So technically, I guess you can presume that she doesn't have the ability to take care of herself. How can she take care of a kid? But that has to be alleged. And so she, in my eyes, she starts with parental rights. And unless someone moves to terminate those and has good reason, I can't imagine a court just, by default taking away her rights.
What about in terms of, say, estate planning for this child? You know, this is who I would want to raise my child should, you know, she pass away or the child's father. I mean, will she be allowed to make those kinds of decisions?
It's tough. It more than likely varies from state to state. So, for example, in Missouri, under a power of attorney, there's certain powers that you have to specifically grant to that agent or else they don't have them. It's presumed that you did not want them to have it. Mm-hmm. And so making custody decisions of a child is going to be something that I don't think a conservator is going to have the complete power to determine. Mm-hmm. And at the end of the day, I mean, if if she's not capable of doing it and the conservator doesn't have power to do it and the other parent didn't do it, it's going to come down to someone then, if they both pass away, just has to go through the standard we're filing for guardianship of a child.
Right. Yeah, I mean, it makes everything complicated. And let me go back to the parenting thing for a minute. I was thinking about this as you were talking, and I'll tell you, I never ran into this situation doing domestic relations. But I think that you do have another human being involved, so I don't think that the guardianship over them would be derivative, would be something that would apply, would attach to this other human being, this other child that's entered the picture. So I think that there'd be a guardianship established for this other child. You can just see how complicated this situation gets. But as I see it, there would have to be somebody who's appointed to protect the child's interest, which is distinctive from the mother's or the person who has the subject of the guardianship, the ward, they're called. So now you have another set of guardians involved who are making decisions, a guardian and a conservative, making decisions just as it affects the child. Now, the good news is, if you can call it that, that if they have additional children, they'll probably fall under the same guardian and same conservative of the children. So at least you won't have, you know, five kids with five sets of guardians, and then the parents have a set of a guardian conservators. But I do think that that's where you'd end up technically. Now, one thing we haven't talked much about here that, in fairness, should be said. There's a development in the law as it pertains to this whole subject of guardianship and conservatorships. Because these are treated by the law as being so grave, and I keep emphasizing this because the law is very attentive. Some of the rules relating to this almost resemble some of the rules protecting the liberty of those who are accused of a crime. If you want to see a lot of technicalities in the law, a lot of protections and barriers and rights, then you can sit in criminal court and watch those proceedings and contrast them to proceedings regarding other subjects, and they're very different. Criminal law is taken seriously in a way that arguably other areas of the law are not, just because they impinge so directly on the most sacred things we have, which is our individual liberty. So in this, there's the same sort of thing that hovers over this subject with the courts, and it's well settled law in virtually all the states that court judges are supposed to choose the remedy for somebody who's apparently incompetent or allegedly incompetent, is to choose the least restrictive remedy. And you see that phrase a lot, mm-hmm. including in the statute. So there is a thing that's been passed in most states around the country where they can choose now versus, you know, 30, 40 years ago. They can choose now to do what's called a limited guardianship or a limited conservatorship, where they can fashion, I think you were referring to this, you might talk a little more about it, but where they get to fashion the order more narrowly so that it's not quite as comprehensive as it would otherwise be. Do you want to talk about that?
Yeah, and so, in fact, I was looking at, in preparation for this, I was kind of browsing through the Missouri statutes, and in their termination or reappointment of a guardian statutes, they state that if evidence comes up or we show that, yes, this person, the ward, is now capable of doing X, Y, and Z things, that the guardian, we can pull back, just like you said, amend the guardianship order to restrict their authority over those items because they're not necessary in those fields anymore. And so, yeah, that's, I'm not sure if California, if that's an option. This may be an all or nothing game there where they can't just carve out certain exceptions, and it may be we either need to leave it in place and dismiss the dad's petition completely to terminate, replace him, which I find to be more, you know, more likely than just dismissing.
Yeah.
Because if he wants out, there's no reason to, it's almost toxic to keep him there. Or they could terminate it completely, but I have a feeling they're going to need some medical backing to do that, just so the court, like you said, the judge is under a lot of media pressure too. So
yeah.
If they terminate it without any kind of finding that she's going to be okay, I think they're going to need to cover their bases.
Now, what if a judge would rule, okay, dad can step down, and say Britney does spiral out of control, even worse than before, is it, and dad wants to be brought back in, is that likely that he would be reinstated, or would we be talking that would be very difficult?
So it depends on the rule. So if the judge terminates the guardianship completely or the conservatorship completely and just says, Britney, you're on your own, good luck, Godspeed. I hope I don't see you again. Then, you know, he would have to essentially start from scratch and say, you know, hey, she's back in her old ways again. You know, here are medical records and the evidence that we have to get me reinstated as a guardian. But if they replace him with someone else, not only is he going to have to say, I'm the best person for the job, she is, you know, still under this conservatorship, they're going to have to prove that the person in place should be removed and replaced by him. So if they replace the person, I think if they replace him with someone else, it'll be much harder for him to get back into position.
Yeah.
Rather than just terminating
completely. Sounds like it would really get hairy.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I think unless she goes downhill in the short term, I think that we're on the road to having this eventually terminated. We were talking just before we went on here about speculating as to why there's not been a petition filed yet by her attorneys, kind of piling on to this suggestion from the other side that, look, let's just end it. In any case, let us out, is what the other side's saying, the father. So normally you would see under those circumstances, the party, in this case her attorneys, saying, well, look, we'll amend our pleading and we'll agree, mm-hmm. and let's just wipe this thing off the table. But I think, as you suggested, there are some hurdles that have to be gotten over, according to the law of California, in which there probably has to be a new psychological evaluation or something that maybe hasn't been done in that form. There's a reason that they haven't mm-hmm. already amended their pleadings, if it's true they haven't.
Yeah.
So there's some things we don't know. We're kind of speculating. But I think we all agree that this is on its way to being thrown out completely. The conservatorship dissolved is what I mean.
Well, yeah. And you know, I want to point out something about that. That's interesting you brought that up, because when this all first started, Adam Streisand was an attorney that the family asked to talk with her. And she said, I want you to be my attorney. I want to hire you. So he petitions the court. The judge says, no, no, no. I have a mental health evaluation, and she's not capable of hiring her own attorney. And Adam Streisand said, I have no idea to this day what was in that mental health evaluation. But he disagreed with the judge's ruling because he felt that she was mentally competent from the interactions he had with her of hiring her own attorney. So that kind of makes me wonder about the whole mental health issue with her, and would she pass a psych exam?
Yeah.
Yeah, and I tend to think she would. I mean, remember, a guardianship or conservatorship is not something you need to fear that you go out of town for a weekend, you come back, and your kids have had you declared incompetent. I mean, this is something that is a real, real difficult bar to get over. I mean, she would have to, the standard, basically, and we'll talk a little bit about this, too, though we may have in our last show. I mean, it really gets down to, are you capable of feeding yourself? Are you capable of keeping a roof over your head? Are you going to harm yourself? Are you going to kill somebody else? And so you're allowed to make really bad decisions. You're allowed to make, bad is not good enough to get you a guardianship imposed on you. So it's such a standard. I cannot imagine she would fail to pass a test.
But wonder what was in that mental health evaluation.
I don't know. But the fact that she when you're in an emergency situation where you think harm is going to happen to that person or they're going to harm someone else, normally you do an emergency hearing for a 96-hour hold. And even that is a pretty high bar. I mean, it's the lowest of the bar because it's an emergency situation, mm-hmm. Almost like a temporary restraining order. The bar's fairly low, mm-hmm. but it's you know, we're waiting for further evidence to come in, but we just don't know if you're going to hurt somebody. But even that's a low, you know, that's a high bar to, even if it's low, it's a higher bar than you would think was present in this case. But she did have a couple of holds before they got this in place.
The same month. It was in January of 2008.
So if they were able to do that twice to her, and I can't remember if they were voluntary or not.
No, they were not.
Yeah. And so once they kind of have that in place and they maybe get whatever other report they had, you know, like you said, we don't know what was in that hearing.
And two, she could have, that's where she was at that time. She was definitely having mental health issues and she may have just had a breakdown, but that doesn't mean that's where she is today.
Right. Right. I mean, 13 years is a long time.
Yeah.
I mean, the difference between an 8-year-old and a 21-year-old
right.
is pretty big.
Right.
And Wall Street Journal had an article yesterday where they talked about the potential of her resuming her career, and apparently there's demand for her that she could sign contracts now to do certain, I don't know what platform online it would be, but like whether it's Netflix or whoever it is, where she could right now sign contracts. There's so much buzz around her, good or bad. I guess infamy is as good as fame.
Mm-hmm. And no, no press is bad press. Is that what they say?
Well, in this in the digital world, that's definitely true. So she could sign contracts now and bring in a big check.
Yeah.
But apparently she's not clear that she wants to do that. And I just read the first paragraph of this.
Well, she did say as long as her dad is on the team, she's not performing, and she has refused to perform. So maybe if dad's out of the picture, she'll go back to work, which I'm sure she would.
I mean, I don't know. She's 40. She has $61 million. Her whole career is based partially on sex appeal. I mean,
yeah.
I think I would probably stop subjecting myself to dancing on stage and starving myself if I had $61 million.
Yeah, but you may not. You're not a narcissist.
Well, that's a good point.
That's, yeah.
That's a good point.
And by the way, did you see that slumber party video?
No, I can't say I did.
Oh, it's not your typical slumber party with girls, you know, eating popcorn, doing their hair, making prank phone calls. Little risque.
Ooh. Well, that doesn't surprise me. But no. I think it's still an unknown. I think that she may have a little bit of a fear of the stage at this stage. She definitely was not clear that she would consider taking these offers. But definitely they're there if she chooses to take them. But she may be done with it. It may be the stress thing.
She could do a reality show.
She kind of is a reality
show.
Well, yeah. She is. She's living one. Yeah. Well, you know, if you think about it, I'm surprised there haven't been movies done about her. There have been documentaries.
There's been a movie? Yep. It was on Lifetime.
Now, Jim, did you miss that movie too?
I missed it, yeah. My DVR must not have auto-recorded the Britney search that I have outstanding.
See, these critical offenses. You probably missed the moon landing and you missed this.
Yeah.
Missed the Britney movie.
I was a little young for the moon landing, I think.
Well, unfortunately, I do remember that. But so Britney, I think we need not fear that she's going to be broke anytime soon. But I think what's going to be interesting is the process by which she gets this eliminated. And again, it's not a foregone conclusion that she'll get this conservatorship eliminated, but I think it's going to happen.
I'd be surprised if they do it today, right? But would not surprise me if they phase it out in some way.
Yeah, over the next 6 months or so.
Yeah.
Still no word.
No?
No breaking news yet.
So we've covered, I think we've covered this topic pretty well. And some may still be wondering, how is this relevant to me? But I think that most of you get it, that if you take this from, you know, it's more sensational heights and the magnitude of this in terms of celebrity and money and fame and media, and think of what happens in the lives of people you know who've had similar battles. That's what we thought this provided a really good opportunity to talk about was how some of the core components are true, you know, if this happened to you or a loved one that we're dealing with here. You don't have to spend as much money as being spent here. And in fact, that's often a handicap that you have if you don't have much money is depending on what the forces are that are arrayed against you. You could find yourself being the victim of a conservatorship and guardianship if you're older, in part through stereotyping and whatnot. And whereas if you'd had the money and the resources, you might could have avoided it. Or at least had the ability to control your money and resources. Maybe I should say that, because often the people who have these sorts of threats come down the road, they're often people who do have some money, but there are others in their family who are more domineering and they tend to push this through. And maybe the older person is not as capable as they would have been 30 years ago of articulating their defense. You know, and so at a point where they're vulnerable, maybe they are cognitively impaired. Doesn't mean they're incompetent, but they're just not capable of mounting the sort of defense that they would they would have 20, 30 years ago. And so I would argue that unlike this situation where we say this really shouldn't have happened, as you said, Jim, when you're looking at where this more common situation where you have, for our purposes, people who are older, it can also be people who are real young, but that's kind of obvious that if you're a 10-year-old by law, you're not competent. Mm-hmm. But on the other extreme, there's stereotyping that happens. And it's a shame, but there are people, a judge is more likely to listen, to believe that an older person may not be capable of making good decisions, in part because of their appearance, in part because of their inability to articulate, then their allegations made against them about dumb or foolish or, you know, just bad things they've done, things that suggest that they're not competent or responsible, when there's a good explanation, but maybe you, if we're talking about you, you're not capable of presenting that explanation. You don't communicate well. So that's a shame that that does happen, I know, among older people. And I don't see a way to head that off easily.
Well, I mean, at the end of the day, you know, I mean, we're talking about Britney Spears and it's fun and all that, and because it's in the news and it's topical. But at the end of the day, the easiest way to not be Britney is to just do your proper planning. So, I mean, a power of attorney, you can name someone to take care of your finances if you're not able to do so for yourself. Someone you trust, someone that's not going to come in and file a petition. And even the powers of attorney we draw up, you know, say that if someone does file a petition with the court trying to be my conservator, try to be my guardian, that I want the people that I've named in my documents to be that person that the court appoints. So,
that's huge.
Yeah. Yeah. So, I mean, it you can prevent it just by saying what you want when you can say that.
Very good point. And that's the reason you're here, Jim, Jim just nailed it. One of the most effective things you can do is to have this durable power of attorney in place. It doesn't mean that the judge has to name the person that you indicated, should you ever be drug into court with somebody making an accusation like this. But the judge is going to sit up and look at it, and there's a good chance the judge will, in fact, choose that person that you've chosen, if, in fact, you lose this at all. But Jim's making the point that there's no need for a guardianship or conservatorship if, in fact, you filled out this document and you have in place a set of rules and someone who can manage without court oversight. Remember, a durable power of attorney is all happening without your estate being sucked up to lawyers and others and being in front of a judge. It's all happening with no court involved. It means you sign this document, you become incompetent, however that's defined. You define it in your document, you and your attorney. And then if on a, I'll use an easy example. You have a stroke on Sunday night and you, Monday, you're not competent. You're lying in the hospital. You're likely to recover mobility, we'll assume, and things like that. Maybe, maybe not. But the point is, there may be lingering cognitive issues. Well, if you didn't have this simple document that you might have paid, you should have paid less than $200 or $300 for, if you didn't have this simple document, the only solution to that situation is going to court with what we've just described,
right.
We've been talking about here. Although in that case, there's a better argument for it, of course, and you yourself may think it's a great idea in that case. But the point is, it's all unnecessary. As you point out, Jim, you nailed it, that the best thing you can do is the durable power of attorney.
Yep.
They don't cost a lot of money, but you want to have a lawyer who prepare that, who does that regularly. And the reasoning is that this isn't just a form. There are some important questions in there that you want answered thoughtfully, and you want to be informed as to what it means whenever you pick someone or you choose a particular provision, such as what's going to trigger it. Is it going to be triggered simply by 2 to 3 people that you trust, a majority of those are unanimous among those before it's triggered? Is it simply going to be your doctor who can say, and there are arguments for each of those? What other decisions?
So the options that we normally put for the definition of incapacity is, you can do a disability panel is what we call the group of individuals, where there's, you know, 2, 3, usually I recommend an odd number, but a group of family members that you trust or friends that can be your disability panel to determine your disability. Or we do 1 or 2 doctor certifications And you can make it so that it's, you know, two, but it, sometimes two is hard to get, especially if we want them to be independent. But normally your primary care physician, we say, you know, your attending physician can certify that. Or we can make them effective immediately. And a lot of the times I, especially if it's between husband and wife as the primary agent, just make it effective immediately so nobody has to, when they get to the bank says, well, it says here we need a doctor's note. Well, doctors are wary of signing off people's financial rights by certifying they can't do it themselves. So sometimes we just make them effective immediately if the situation calls for it.
Yeah. And remember, effective immediately doesn't mean you lose your rights. It just means that technically the person you've chosen could also do things during this period of time for you. It doesn't mean that if it's in effect immediately that you can't do anything. So you've lost nothing by having a provision like that. If it's somebody you trust, then why would you worry that technically they could go the next day and withdraw money from your account, for example. But if you think they're going to do that while you're competent, what do you think they're going to do when you're incompetent?
You don't want to select that person.
Yep. Yeah, so I think it's probably the most common choice, is it not, to simply have it go into effect immediately?
It is. And normally this is going to be, like I said, a spouse or backup to the spouse is your children. And you pick the children you trust. You don't pick the child with the gambling problem or the drinking problem. So yeah, you trust that person. And sometimes I just tell people, you know, they ask what's effective immediately mean? And do I give up my rights? And I say, no, absolutely not. But if you just don't feel like going to the bank one day, send them to the bank with your power of attorney and they can do everything that you'd be able to do.
Yeah. Yeah, it's such a powerful, powerful thing, and it's sad. It's sad that there are a lot of people who don't have it, and they have some incident where a lot of money is used in the court system with lawyers. So I think we've covered this topic pretty well.
And still no updates. That's a long hearing.
Yeah,
I
might toss and turn tonight if we don't get an answer to this
question.
All right, I don't mean to be so dismissive about her. Mm-hmm. I do wish her the best. So, time has flown. We've covered a lot of material. I hope you found it interesting and useful. With us today was Jim Gau. Jim Gau's with TuckerAllen. He practices exclusively in the area of estate planning. So, Jim, we definitely want to have you on in the future, talk about these issues.
Happy to do it.
So, this has been another episode of Elder Talk. Till next time, take care.
You've been listening to Elder Talk with TuckerAllen, providing intelligent answers for those thinking about their future with Attorney-CPA Joe Cordell. Sponsored by TuckerAllen, your estate and elder law advisors. For more information, visit TuckerAllen.com. Listen again next Saturday for another edition of Elder Talk with TuckerAllen. The choice of a lawyer is an important decision and should not be based solely on advertisements.